Ladies and gentlemen, I know this panel is standing between you and lunch, but that's no fault of ours. It is the fault of the previous session, which was extremely enriched the knowledge base and wisdom of the audience, certainly me, because each time I attend a conference on the subject of firstly blue economy and secondly particularly dealing with sustainable growth in fisheries, one finds that one has not studied enough and one has not researched enough. So the topic that I was given to dwell upon is India's maritime economy and the maritime security imperatives for India, which are huge in today's environment of non-traditional threats. First of all, I would like to say that one has to understand that man, which is a generic term, man and woman, humankind, is a continental creature, because 99% of us have our feet on terra firma and we feel that there is nothing beyond Earth. Beyond the entire Earth, we feel, is actually composed of only terra firma, forgetting that 72% of the planet on which we reside is composed of water, the oceans. And when it comes to India, you will realize how important it is to protect as well as to extract the maximum out of the potential of the oceans. Look at this picture. This is a cartographer's delight. The west coast as well as the east coast, and particularly the peninsula of India, which dominates the entire Indian Ocean. No other country in this region or beyond has such properties. Now, one is to understand that maritime countries are naturally blessed. Why? Why do I say that? Because they have the added advantage, which is natural, of large gateways or windows to the rest of the world. There are no barriers at sea. That's how you create ports and shipyards, etc. In contrast, landlocked countries, 44 poor landlocked countries, well, Switzerland and Austria are not poor, nor is Liechtenstein. But in contrast, they are lesser haves because they do not have access to the seas. So we should count our blessings that not only are we a maritime state, but three sides of the Indian landmass which juts into the Indian Ocean, called the peninsula, is open to the sea. That's the Indian peninsula. Now, in this picture, I want you to concentrate on the red line, which will start now, that we talk with a lot of emphasis on 15,000 kilometers of our land borders, which is an impressive figure. And people say, my God, you got such a huge landmass that you have 15,000 kilometers of land borders, which means, apart from responsibility, a lot of assets. Not really. Because you know, because of contemporary history and geography, geography meaning terrain across this red line as well as the green lines, there is no possibility of transit of economic features. You cannot transact business across these lines. Therefore, for all practical purposes, India may be called an island insofar as its economy is concerned, its economic engagement with the rest of the globe is concerned. Because it's a fact of life that 90% by volume and 77% by value of our seaborne of our entire trade has no alternative but to go by sea. One more aspect that must be built into our minds is the fact that the peninsula that I showed you is not very small. And if you go on the net, you will find the six largest peninsulas, which are talked about now and every now and then, have the Arabian Peninsula at 3.2 million square kilometers, which is the entire landmass area of India, as number one. But it comprises of 10 countries, including Jordan, which is a landlocked country. Then the Alaskan Peninsula at 1.5, the Labrador Peninsula at 1.3 million square kilometers, the Scandinavian one at 0.8, And finally, the Iberian Peninsula, comprising of Portugal and Spain, had only 0.58 million square kilometers. Which is the peninsula in this world which is at number two in the Indian Peninsula, comprising of only one country at 2.07 million square kilometers, almost equal to the EEZ of India. So that's a great asset that we have got, we never realize. You've got three sides open to the ocean with nobody interrupting your EEZ except Sri Lanka and Maldives. And that is why you have a huge EEZ, and that is why you've got 200 plus ports, of which 12 are major ports. One is a corporate sector port, Ennore, and 190 plus are minor and intermediate ports. So what is it that gives you the maritime economic potential to India from this maritime domain? The EEZ is in the light blue shaded area, 2.02 million square kilometers. It's an enviable figure. The only other countries which have got large EEZs are France, because of its island territories in the Pacific apart from its mainland, which is very small, a very small coastline. Archipelagos like Indonesia and Philippines. And of course, certain other island group of nations in the Indian Ocean, which are scattered. For example, the Maldives has a total land area of only 297 square kilometers against 3.2 million square kilometers of India. But while India has 2.02 million square kilometers of EEZ, Maldives has 900,000 square kilometers of EEZ. Apart from being an asset, it's a huge burden for them because it's a small and a poor country. Poor in the sense that it cannot afford to have large maritime forces to look after, to keep a check, and to continuously keep their EEZ under surveillance against wrongdoers. Another point to notice in this slide is that our two island territories, the Lakshadweep on the west, which I have deliberately not shown because the EEZ there is very small, but the Andaman Nicobar Islands in the east, 800 miles away from mainland, contribute 33% of our EEZ at 660,000 square kilometers. And there are large hydrocarbon reserves which have not yet been tapped. There are large shoals of fish which have not been fully exploited over there. So what does the EEZ to a country like India provide you? The one thing that comes naturally to a person's mind is beautiful beaches, which, as you heard in the last presentation, offer you a great opportunity for tourism and therefore generating revenue for the country. Mineral resources, particularly oil and gas. Fish, which we take for granted, which you heard in the last session, is actually a huge potential which has been untapped on the East Coast and particularly in the deeper waters, because we haven't allowed fisheries to develop in an organized fashion. On the West Coast, all shallow gradient. Therefore, pelagic fish is what is caught generally, and many areas have been overexploited. But on the East Coast, deep waters are just, you know, a few miles away from the coast, particularly south of Kakinada and north of Chennai. In that area, the EEZ is very, very deep. And we haven't got too many trawlers who can go only up to about 200 meters. No one goes beyond that. That requires a lot of focus in trying to encourage people to invest in those areas and acquire trawlers at subsidies, with subsidies given by the government. Mineral resources. India was one of the first seven countries in 1987 to be given pioneer status by the International Seabed Authority for extraction of polymetallic nodules. But now things have changed and technologies have become so expensive to extract nodules, because many of these polymetallic extracts have been found on land in various countries, and therefore focus has shifted to sulfides, which has also started off in the central Indian Ocean basin, where we've got a real estate of about 10,000 square kilometers. The other asset that a maritime state enjoys is core sector of strategic industries. all core sector industries in every country like to be located next to the sea coast for two reasons. Firstly, abundance of water, even if it is saline water. You can always convert for cooling facilities and for various other purposes. And secondly, many industries like to have captive ports so that their own raw material import or export of their produce can easily be sent out, or if there is a private or a government-owned port close by, then they can have conveyor belts for their imports and exports. You've heard a lot of, about fisheries in India in the last session. I'll not go dilate on the subject except to say that we have a long way to go to modernize and organize our fisheries in order to start gaining the exact potential that lies untapped, particularly on the East Coast and in deeper waters. This is one picture of one of our major ports, which I keep saying is 1942, a love story, which refuses to modernize. Many of our major ports are in this state, except that some major ports have done a very sensible thing over the last two decades by leasing out some of their berths to international players like Port of Singapore Authority or Dubai Port World, which are doing pretty well. This is another mess in some of our major ports. Logistics and evacuation. Huge queues and completely disorganized roadways and railways connecting those ports to the interland, because our town planning has been in a mess after the British left us. This is what is required. A private port in Gujarat, you all heard about Mundra. The way it has been galloping in throughput figures year after year, it crossed 100 million tons 3 years ago, beating Kandla, which was the heaviest throughput port till then. A container carrier comes in easily into Mundra and doesn't think of going to a transshipment port like Colombo or Salalah or Fujairah or whatever else in the UAE or to Singapore. They all used to avoid Indian major ports because they said the dwell time in Indian ports is terrible. We don't want to waste our money. Now they go to Mundra. A container carrier offloads its containers within a span of 12 to 24 hours and loads containers and moves them. This is a picture of another private port, Gangavaram, on the east coast of India. This is the kind of modern infrastructure that is required. Shipyards. We are laggards insofar as creating shipyards in this country are concerned. The public sector undertaking shipyards, most of them are under the Defense Ministry, are unfortunately located in such areas where there is not enough depth of water. And they are still, even though most of them have modernized, they are still living under systems which are set up in the 50s and 60s, which means too much manpower. Automation is required. But private ports, private shipyards need to be established and encouraged with subsidies. Seabed sulfides, I just touched upon it, is the new game rather than nodules, which have a huge potential for garnering rare earths and precious metals like gold, silver, platinum, but particularly rare earths, where China has got a 95% monopoly for the entire world. Inland waterways. You've been hearing in recent years, 1986, this country set up an inland waterways authority. We have 14,500 kilometers of inland waterways. Only about 2,000 kilometers have been utilized, I wouldn't say fruitfully, but partially. Now there is a great push over the last 2 years to encourage a lot of traffic, particularly in the largest national waterway, which goes from Allahabad to Haldia. Even if the depth is just 2.5 to 3 meters, it doesn't matter. Imagine Mississippi and Ohio River systems have an average depth of only 3 to 3.2 meters. And they have almost 20% of national and international cargo going through the river system. Because A, it is eco-friendly, least amount of pollution. B, it is the cheapest mode of transport compared to road and rail. Look at this picture. It came out in Stratfor's INT document about 5 years ago. There was no story, but this picture tells you 1,000 words. Why is Germany richer than Italy? Look at the tributaries and the river systems inside Germany and those in Italy. Just one of those aspects of comparison of potential. You've heard in my predecessor's presentation, Ms. Neela Lard's presentation about cruise tourism, but there are so many opportunities on peninsular India, starting with beaches. The entire pink shaded area is beaches in India. The blue shaded ones are major beaches like Goa, etc. You know, people from Europe and North America will pay anything to come down to sun-baked beaches, which we avoid and we don't know how to utilize. And there are so many sites of BCE era, including Buddhist sites on the east coast of India, which will generate so much revenue if you were to encourage tourism. And the last part of my presentation deals with maritime security. Where you have opportunities, you also have challenges. And you must look after those challenges head on. The first point that I wish to make is to look at the Indian Ocean, the North Indian Ocean in particular, with a very, very keen eye. This is an ocean entirely different from the Pacific and the Atlantic. Despite being the smallest, it has a roof over its head, provided by the Indian Peninsula, the Makran Coast, and Bangladesh, which is not a very good thing for any water body. It chokes an ocean. It landlocks an ocean. Unlike the Atlantic and the Pacific, there are no windows and gateways. And the only access windows for entry and exit into this ocean are through 8 choke points. These are the choke points. And choke points are very bad, not just for navigation, not just for natural disasters, but particularly for providing safe havens and shelter to transnational criminals. That's why piracy took root first in the Malacca, then in the Gulf of Aden. That's why terrorism took root off Aden and, of course, emanated from Pakistan. These are the seaborne, the sea trade routes or sea lines of communication that crisscross the Indian Ocean, particularly around the Indian Peninsula. 120,000 ships on an average pass through this area, and most of them close to the Indian Peninsula every year. 70,000 of them pass through the Malacca Strait. So what are these non-traditional threats which have sidestepped traditional threats? Traditional meaning conquest of somebody else's territory from the sea. What are non-traditional threats? Particularly since 9/11, and particularly after the last episode of traditional threat that you saw between Iraq and Kuwait, it is non-traditional threats which have become huge challenges for maritime states to counter and to preempt. The most important one of them, and the most critical, is maritime terrorism. You remember USS Cole took place in 2000, 1 year before 9/11. MV Lindbergh took place 1 year after 9/11 in 2002. Both of them in or off Aden Harbor. Mumbai, 26/11, in this city, doesn't have to be dwelt upon. We all know what happened. These guys came from the sea. It's all maritime terrorism from Pakistan. Piracy and armed robbery, on which I have already touched, Gulf of Aden, Malacca Strait. It's still alive, though Gulf of Aden has been controlled because of many navies' presence, including particularly the Indian Navy. Sabotage and arson, which takes place in many parts of the world in ports, and it can be a huge burden as well as a showstopper insofar as economic potential and economic encouragement of the maritime domain is concerned. This is a picture of one of the ports with containers lined up, but it doesn't show you thousands of cars which are also there in a port. So imagine what will happen if there is sabotage or arson in a port. Human trafficking and smuggling, including stowaways on ships, is a major challenge, particularly in our part of the world. Drug and gun running, which is creating chaos insofar as connection with terrorists is concerned. And you heard about IUU in the last session. So poaching has been an old trade by many maritime states. China is a champion of IUU. It steals, literally steals fish from EEZs apart from the open high seas beyond EEZs of other countries. All over the world except the Europe, West European coast, and North America. As if all these were not enough, one of the major challenges insofar as maritime security is concerned for maritime forces of the world is natural disasters. And this is a picture of the tsunami of Chennai. You know the kind of devastation that it wreaked in 2004. Once again, this is a challenge, even though it is natural, which has to be looked after by navies and coast guards. So what do we need as a remedy for looking after maritime security? Not just maritime forces, because they're very expensive, but also teaching others and the lesser haves and cooperation amongst all countries. So we do a lot of cooperation through Navy-to-Navy exercises in order to establish interoperability, in order to establish synergies. That's the end of